Hello and welcome. This is an actual practice that I'm uploading to my YouTube channel. My name is Mike Damasi and I am presenting the tradition of Vinyasa Krama that my teacher Srivatsa Ramaswami transmits, as was transmitted to him through his teacher Sri T Krishnamacharya. It's a traditional vinyasa system. It's called Vinyasa Krama. So I'll start by chanting an invocation to the sage Patanjali, who is said to have authored the important yoga text called the Yoga Sutra. Not to worry if people are a bit skittish about religious matters. This is non-religious. It's just a customary invocation to honor the sage and honor the lineage of teachers that transmitted these valuable teachings on yoga. So I'll start with this invocation. You can sit comfortably with an erect spine. Om Aindukaratane Ane Mohatane Indini Lampere Pondre Etrane Nandi Mahandane Jnana Kurundane Pondeva Itadiputru Enrene Yastyaktva Rupamadyam Prabhavadi Jagato Nekada Nugrahaya Prakshina Kleshara Shravishama Vishadaro Neka Vaktra Subhogi Sarvajnana prasutir bhushaka parikara priteye yasya nityam nevo hisha savo vyacita vimalatanur yogado yoga yuktaha yogena cittasya padena vacham alam sharirasya chavaidyakena yopakarottam pravaram muninam patanjalim pranjarira natosmi Abahu Purushakaram Shankha Chakrasidharinam Sahasra Shirasham Shvetam Pranamami Patanjalim Srimate Anantaya Nagarajaya Namo Namaha Asmadacharye Bhyasre Bhyo Namo Namaha. Right, thanks again for joining. Before we actually begin the practice, I'd like to give some background. So as I mentioned, we customarily start with this invocation to honor the sage Patanjali. And the text that he authored, the Yoga Sutra, is largely a text that's governing a methodology toward the pursuit of a mental state that is defined as yoga through the principal practices of internal procedures of seated meditation practice to go internally. There's meant to be a preparation that's external in nature that leads you to then quieter and more still practices in which we sit for meditation proper. To cultivate this mental state. It's certainly not a mental state that can be cultivated in a single practice or even a single weekend workshop or a teacher training. It's more like a lifelong practice or sadhana. In any case, in this respect, Krishnamacharya, his teachings predominantly revolved around the breath. If you're familiar with Ashtanga Vinyasa, you'll recognize that, of course, this is broadly speaking considered a breathing practice, but you may recognize it's a little different the way the breath is treated in this traditional Vinyasa Krama, as I'm going to present to you. It's asking you to develop a certain sensitivity. And in fact, for persons that are somewhat disconnected with their body, a lot of people are when they first start, even people that typically attend popular flow classes may not actually be so connected to their breathing, even though they might attend a weekly flow class after work or something, let alone their body itself. So to begin with, I'd like to focus on simple movements. And for the person that is quite adept physically, maybe they'll find this boring, but I ask you just to bear with me and have patience. I'm asking you to develop a certain sensitivity, and this practice is governed by a sensitive approach of the breath. It may be different than what you're familiar with. So please bear with me and have patience and just really try what I'm asking you to do. It may seem boring, it may seem beneath you, but honestly, this is actually what my teacher explains is the nectar of Krishnamacharya's teachings, this exquisite treatment of the breath, which brings us a certain sensitivity. Now, where we bring our attention to the sensations in the body through cultivating this sense of sensitivity is where essentially the vital energy is being concentrated, prana. So there's a certain connection with where we draw our senses to and where the prana is directed. If we can channel the prana a particular manner, we can concentrate the mind and draw in the otherwise outwardly drawn sense organs. Anyways, not to get so technical, this is the basis of this practice, the background. If you want some background to the term vinyasa and then krama, you may be familiar with the term vinyasa, just referring movement or flow type practice, maybe also linked with the breath. This is not incorrect, but there's some nuance lost in this definition. The term vinyasa is a technical one, is a combination of the prefix vi and the word nyasa. The word nyasa is actually coming from ritual procedures where there are certain mantras that are placed on certain points in the body, which can also be utilized with the touch of the hand to direct attention to specific points as you chant certain mantras. It's a part of ritual procedure seen in Vedic ritual. Also, you see this in tantric ritual. There's the use of nyasa as well. Nevertheless, Krishnamacharya himself was coming staunchly from a Vedic tradition. And the prefix vi denotes vishesha, which is actually referring particular or special kinds of nyasa. And again, nyasa is a particular placement. A nyasa could also be the way you place the body, like an asana itself. And krama means to do so in steps. Integral to this practice, like I said, is the breathing. It's meant to be done with a particular type of breathing, which then governs the movements to be of a particular nature as well. So proper respiration is to bring slow movements, long breathing, which governs slow movements. So with that in mind, not to do asana without vinyasa implies that we must practice with this proper respiration. Okay, so let's begin in a supine position, just lying down. And just to bring a certain sensitivity, just be lying down with the knees bent, the feet on the ground in a comfortable way. You can place your hands, your arms on the floor, palms face up, and just stay here for a while. Again, we're starting with very simple procedures just so that you start to get the hang of what I'm asking you to do in terms of the breathing, in terms of the movement. There'll be plenty of time to get into more complicated asanas and shapes that you may be more familiar with. In fact, I encourage you to watch subsequent practices that I may upload in the future, where we will get into more and more variety of asanas you may be familiar with and more rigorous procedures. Indeed, the scope of Vinyasa Krama that Ramaswami Sir teaches is identical to the scope you may be familiar with in other popular schools like Ashtanga Vinyasa or Iyengar Yoga, which incidentally are coming from the same root of Sri T Krishnamacharya. So anyways, lying here, just begin to watch your natural breathing. Keep the eyes closed and just go internally. The focus is on the breath. Now place one or both hands on the abdomen. Just notice the movement that occurs with your breathing. Having the hands there help to have a tactile sensation which directs the attention to that particular point and how the breath permeates this point in the body. Again, to direct the attention there is to direct the prana, and it's intrinsically linked to the breathing process as outlined. So naturally, you may notice with the exhalation, there's an inherent contraction, gentle contraction in the abdomen. Particularly in this lying down position, you'll notice with each exhale, naturally the navel wants to move back towards the spine. Don't try to manipulate the breath just yet. Just watch the breath without judgment. Appreciate the movement of the breathing. Now, bring one hand or both hands to the chest. Continue to watch the breath like this, still not controlling the breath, but just observing the natural breathing and the natural movements that occur now in the chest region. Again, I'm asking you to become sensitive to the subtleties of the breathing and its impact on parts of the body. Now I'd like you to place one hand on the abdomen and one hand on the chest. Continue to observe the breath now with two separate points to pay attention to. Maybe you notice that the inhale is bringing small expansion to the chest on inhalation. And as I said, the exhalation is the inherent gentle contraction in the abdomen. Now, with the two hands on these two spots, bring your attention to both places as it pertains to the movements directed by the breathing and the diaphragm. Now I'd like you to bring a slight constriction at the pit of the throat, creating a gentle hissing sound with rubbing sensation. So pay attention to the sensation in the throat. Again, it's more important than the sensation than necessarily making a loud sound. Don't make the throat so dry by trying to make it so loud the sound. It could be actually quite subtle and quiet. This technique is known as Ujjayi. So now try to elongate the breathing. Try to slow down the velocity of the breathing intentionally, bringing the breath under gentle control. If it feels uncomfortable, you can release this and go back to normal breathing. But little by little, try to become comfortable with the breath. Become friends with the breath. Become aware of the breath, little by little, attaining to control of the breath. So first, maybe you will notice that you can elongate the exhalation. This is natural. With the parasympathetic nervous system, which is the rest and digest aspect of the nervous system, it's natural to lean on or lean into a long, comfortable exhale. It can be even longer than the inhale itself. So start with that. So again, how do you do this hissing sound? It's a bit like whispering, except with the lips sealed. You can test it out by trying to whisper and then just keeping the sound going with the lips sealed. Then you can do the same thing on inhale. What occurs anatomically is the valve that you would otherwise close when drinking water or swimming. Here, we're bringing it under deliberate control in the breathing process, gently narrowing the passage in which the air moves through in the throat. Again, pay attention to the sensation at this point in the throat. Something else that is useful is using sound, such as the pranayama technique called bhramari. Bhramari implies mimicking the buzzing of a bumblebee. How do we do this? We do this with creating a humming sound. We only do this on the exhalation. So with each exhale, see about humming for as long as you could comfortably do so. And just gently observe how you can begin to elongate the exhale, slowing the velocity with which you expel the air as you gently, deliberately contract the navel to the spine in stages. So you can begin with the humming technique, taking a deep inhalation. And when you're ready, at your pace, humming. Keep breathing in this manner. See if you can extend the exhale a little bit. Using sound is a great tool because it also is something you can pay attention to in terms of the sensations of where the sound is resonating within your body. Now I'd like you to place the hands on the floor, but with the palms face down. So now, without the help of the hands on the chest and abdomen, as a tactile feedback, to watch the breathing apparatus, try to watch these points in the breathing without necessarily use of touch. You can continue with the Brahmari, or maybe you would like to go back to Ujjayi and continue to work on elongating the breath, but without using the tool of sound. So long exhale, and if you can completely empty the lungs effectively, then you have more space to take a full and deep inhalation. So continue like this. Now you can relax the breathing. So now we'll combine arm movements. So with these arm movements, what we'll do is raise just the right arm overhead as so, and then we'll switch to the left arm, okay? So first let's do it with natural breathing using this pace. So just go back to normal breathing. And now when you're ready, inhaling, exhaling, lower the arm. Now inhale the opposite arm, exhale, lower the arm. Now, just stay here for a moment. Let's try to control the breath now. So the natural breathing, maybe the normal breathing is just maybe 2 second inhale, 2 second exhale, or maybe 3 second inhale, 3 second exhale. But let's try to control the breath. Let's try to bring the breath to maybe 4 second inhale, 4 second exhale. Let's see. So I'll count for you. Let's do it the right side first. So inhale, right arm first. One, two. two, three, four. And now exhale, lower the arm. One, two, three, four. Now the left arm. Inhale, slowly take your left arm up. Two, three, four. And then exhale, slowly lower your arm. Two, three, four. Let's raise both arms now. Now the count of four for inhale, count of four for exhale. So when you're ready, inhale, slowly take both arms. Two, three, four. Exhale, slowly lower both arms. Two, three, four. Now relax for a moment. So really enjoy the breathing with this movement. In this Vinyasa Krama system, there's often a repeated dynamic movement to enter a posture where you can really appreciate the breathing through the dynamic movement, working with this long, smooth breathing. So as we begin to lengthen the breath, we should not compromise on how smooth it is, the quality of it being smooth. If it becomes jagged because we're trying too hard to lengthen it, it's not good. We're straining. There should be no strain in the breathing, and indeed, there should be no strain in the postures. Should be firm but comfortable. Now, let's try to elongate the breath to 5 second inhale, 5 second exhale. We'll do again right arm and then left arm, and then and we'll try with both arms. So 5 seconds. Now, when you're ready, inhale, right arm first. Two, three, four, five. And then exhale, slowly lower the right arm. Two, three, four, five. Now inhale, slowly raise your left arm. Two, three, four, five. And then exhale, slowly lower your left arm. Two, three, four, five. Now inhale both arms. I won't count, just go internally. And then exhale, slowly lower both arms. It's 5 second count on inhale, 5 second count on exhale. Exhale. Now relax. Now we're going to do movements because this is mostly working on the rib cage, the inhalation. Let's work on the exhalation and the abdomen. So, what we're going to do is this kind of a movement where we take our hands to the knee, one knee at a time. So we'll do taking the knee to the chest and the hands to the knee on exhale. Just watching for now. With the inhale, you could still have the hand to the knee and just straighten the arms. The knee naturally goes away on inhale, the spine straightens, and then exhale again, take the knee to the chest. And then on inhale this time, you can take the foot to the floor. Coming out. What you could do also at this point is raise your arms and then after the second side. So when you're ready, exhale completely, empty the lungs. Let's start with 4 second count. Okay. Now inhale, take both arms overhead. Two, three, four. And now exhale, right knee to the chest. Two, three, four, the hands come to the knee. And then inhale, still hold the knee and just straighten the spine. 4 seconds. And now exhale, knee to the chest, draw the belly in. 4 seconds. And now inhale, just take the foot to the floor and arms overhead. And then exhale, you could lower your arms down by your sides. 4 seconds. Now let's do the left side. So inhale, take your arms overhead, 4 seconds, two, three, four. Exhale, take your left knee to the chest, take the hands to the knee. Now still holding the knee with an inhale, just straighten the arms, straighten the spine, moving the knee away. And then exhale, take the knee to the chest, three, four. And now inhale, take the arms overhead, place the foot on the floor. And then exhale, slowly take your arms down, three, four. Okay, now let's try it. 5 seconds inhale, 5 seconds exhale. Okay, so with an inhale, take both arms overhead, two, three, four, five. Exhale, take your right knee to the chest, two, three, four, five. Still holding the knee, inhale, just stretch the spine, straighten it, and then exhale, take the knee to the chest, two, three, four, five. And then inhale, place the foot on the floor and arms overhead, slowly, deliberately, mindfully. And now exhale, you can slowly take your arms down, two, three, four, five. Second side, inhale, take your arms overhead, two, three, four, five. Exhale, left knee to the chest, two, three, four, five. Still holding the knee on inhale, straighten your arms, straighten your spine. And then exhale, take the knee to the chest, draw the belly in. Then inhale, take your arms overhead, foot to the floor, three, four, five. Try to coordinate your movement. Exhale, take your arms down by your sides. And try to place the hands on the floor at the same time. So really pay attention to how you move through space. Okay. Now let's try with both hands to both knees. So inhale, just take your arms overhead. Three, four, five. And now exhale, take both knees to the chest and take the hands to the knees. Four, five, contracting in the abdomen. Here, inhale, keep the hands on the knees, but straighten the arms, straighten the spine. Exhale, draw the belly in, knees to the chest. Four, five. Then inhale, take the feet to the floor, arms overhead. Try to coordinate the movement. The feet and the hands at the same time if possible. Exhale, take the arms down. If it's not possible, the feet and the hands at the same time, try to have the feet touch down together and the hands touching down at the same time. If they don't, just notice that they don't and maybe try to bring attention to this and the quality of the movement. So this seems simple enough, but it helps to start to bring attention to the body through the vehicle of the breath. So don't assume that because it's simple, it's not impactful. It's actually quite subtle, and you might notice that it brings quite a big impact on your well-being to do this kind of a practice. Now, when you're ready, you could turn to the right side and gently come up to a seated position when you're ready, easing your way up to a seated position. Now, in a cross-leg position, if you feel like your spine is curving, your knees are not coming down, you have difficulty sitting comfortably, maybe you could benefit from sitting higher on a blanket, a folded blanket, maybe on a yoga brick. And maybe you'll notice this allows your inner thighs to open up and you can lower your knees. If it's not enough height, you can come sit higher, maybe a second cushion, maybe using a brick. and maybe your knees come down a bit and your spine is more erect rather than rolling back, trying to sit on the floor. Okay. If you're not comfortable at all sitting on the floor, of course you could be doing all of this these kinds of stuff sitting on a chair or on the edge of your bed. You know, the lying positions can be done on your bed comfortably, the simple lying positions, the lying movements. Now, the same thing goes if you're going to necessarily extend your legs out. So if you're sitting on the floor and you're extending your legs along the floor, maybe you have a hard time lifting your spine. You're trying to sit upright, but you're sort of rolling back, right? Maybe it helps to bend your knees, and then you could come closer to the front edges of your sit bones to sit upright, roll your shoulders back with an erect spine. Maybe it's easier. If you straighten your legs, maybe you start to compromise the posture, which again, if you notice this, maybe all the help of the hands pushing on the ground will not help this. Or maybe it'll be temporary because once you release your hands, you don't have the integrity anymore because your hands are not helping. You need to be able to lift with the side trunk. And if that's not possible sitting straight on the floor, you can sit higher on a cushion or two cushions, and maybe you can start to lift your spine more. Just with the gentle support of the fingers on the ground, maybe with an extra height. If you're too high from the ground at that point, the hands could be on the support itself. And maybe now you can feel you can lift the spine, sit more towards the front edges of your sit bones. All right. With the spine erect, the shoulders rolling back, the chest well open. In any case, let's come up to standing position. So when you're ready, you can slowly come up. Can remove the support. So now, in this standing position, so my teacher Ramaswami sir likes to teach us the principles of this Vinyasa Krama system in a sequence called Tadasana sequence. So Tadasana can be referring hill pose, but it also can mean palm tree. And indeed, when you're standing in the classical position with the feet together, the body resembles a palm tree when the arms are overhead. Otherwise, when the arms are down, the starting position is just samasthiti. If it's not comfortable to have the feet together, you can have them apart. Okay? It could be hips distance apart or whatnot. If it's comfortable, maybe you can have the feet together. This is samasthiti. Sama, the first part of this word, implies even. Sthiti means steady. So we're meant to stand evenly on the two feet. So there's many types of movements you can do just from this starting point with the feet together, even. Different kinds of movements. It forms this Tadasana sequence. Indeed, there's all kinds of movements you can do with the body in any position, be it in this kind of a standing plane, or could be in the lying down plane, or in the seated plane. Different kinds of movements you can do. So a good rounded practice tends to have some movements of each of these kinds of categories, whether it's in the flexion of the spine or the extension of the spine or the lateral stretch of the spine or the twisting of the spine. This can occur all within this starting point with the feet together. It can also occur in variations with the feet apart. There's many such movements you could do while sitting down, bending forward, or you can twist, or you can do a lateral stretch. You can lift back to a counter pose, which is the extension. So many such movements. It's not that complicated at that point. There's just flexion, there's lateral stretch, there's the twisting, there's the backward movement. Backward movement is essentially the opposite of the forward movement, the extension, which is opposite to the flexion. Expansive movements are done on inhalation. Should be intuitive. And the contracting movements are done on exhalation. It's not complicated. Sometimes an expansive movement can feel strong. And if we're having some weakness, we can make it easier for ourselves to instead move on such an expansive movement rather than on an exhalation. That could be suitable for different individuals, depending on what's appropriate to them. Otherwise, the classical manner is the expansive movements on inhale, contracting movements always on exhale. So the contracting movements are not to be done on inhalation as such. That's not the proper respiration. But the inhale movements classically are on inhalation, but can be done on exhalation. So when in doubt, move on exhale. Inhalation is only for expansive movements. You can't do inhalation on a contracting movement, at least in this methodology. So samasthiti, standing evenly on the two feet. Begin to sense the feet grounding down, active in the feet, in the inner arches. The legs are active. Even gently nudge the tailbone in, bringing a sense of awareness to the pelvic floor. Again, this is bringing a certain sensitivity. It doesn't even have to be what you may be familiar with in certain other practices where you bring a strong muscular engagement. Just bring awareness, and then gentle contraction will eventually come. This is with control, and with control, you must also be conscious to be able to release, not unconsciously gripping. That's another thing. Now from here, feel this side waist lifting up, even the armpit chest lifting and the shoulders rolling back. And from here, feel the back of the neck long, and you could even start to lower your chin towards the lifted chest. Doesn't have to touch the chest, but you can gently nod in the direction of what's known as Jalantara Bandha. And all of these movements with the arms will actually keep the chin lowered. This is the manner in which my teacher explains it to us. He teaches it to us. Indeed, if you see photographs of his teacher, T. Krishnamacharya, with the arms raised, he's often with the chin lowered. So just be in samasthiti, and you can now close the eyes and just watch the balance, assessing the shifting of the weight from side to side, foot to foot. Naturally, there's oscillations. Just be sensitive to that. There's the right and the left, but there's also the center. maybe try to become more and more aware of where that center is. The more you can connect to the center, the more balanced you'll be, which is what is implied by the name Samastiti. Do this with eyes closed. Now, bring attention to the point at the center of the chest. This point, my teacher refers to as pranasthana, the point of prana. Prana, again, is this vital energy that is essentially what animates us. It animates the living. It's related to the breath, but it's not synonymous with the breath. The breath is a vehicle to which we can look at the prana, but it's not the same exactly. But focus on this point where it appears the breath is initiated behind the sternum, where it brings expansion to the chest and contraction in the abdomen. So here, with the eyes closed, so here, I'm not indicating to place the hands on the abdomen and chest. You could, of course, do that. It might help to have that tactile sensation, feedback, to feel the expansion of the chest on inhale and the contraction of the abdomen on exhale. Or you can do it without the hands touching and just bring your attention to those points without requiring the physical touch of the hands. Choose your medicine, whether or not to use the hands. Now, let's bring attention again to the throat region to bring that gentle hissing sound with rubbing sensation, the Ujjayi technique. This is a technique that we'll utilize throughout the practice of the asanas. Again, if you need to go to normal breathing, if it's too much strain to necessarily try to lengthen the breath and control the breathing while doing these movements, you can do that, but eventually try to become friendly with the breath without causing strain. Just be friendly with it, aware of it, eventually coaxing it in a particular direction. Otherwise, you can try to elongate the breath to 5 second inhale and a 5 second exhale. With the chin gently lowered and nod in the direction of Jalandhar Bandha, it helps us connect to this Ujjayi in the throat. It localizes the sensation in the throat. Now you can open your eyes. So it's a lot of preparation, a lot of talking, a lot of preparation. I'm very sorry that we are not getting into a lot of practice as of yet, but it's a lot of preliminary stuff that I think is important to become aware of. So now let's begin with some simple arm movements. So what we'll do is take the arms out to the sides and up on inhale, and we'll actually interlace the fingers once they're there. So the eyes are open. And from Samasthiti, begin to inhale, and now I'll take your arms out to the sides and up. Keep the chin lowered. Really feel the expansion on the sides of the chest, the side trunk, interlace the fingers, stretching up. So now the chin is to the lifted chest, and now exhale slowly. Lower the hands down by the sides. Inhale, slowly take your arms out to the sides and up. Really lift your waist, expand your chest. Exhale, slowly lower your arms down. Breathe out, breathe out, breathe out, breathe out, breathe out. Once again, inhale, slowly take your arms out to the sides and up. Really appreciate the breathing through the dynamic movement. And exhale, slowly lower your arms down by your sides. Now, let's try raising the arms up from the front and notice the difference in the quality of the stretch. Now inhale, slowly take the arms up from the front. Feel the stretch in the front body. Keep the chin down to the chest that's lifted. Exhale, slowly lower the arms from the front. Inhale, slowly take your arms up from the front. Exhale, slowly lower your arms down from the front. Once again, inhale, slowly take your arms up from the front. Exhale, slowly lower your arms down from the front. Now stay in Samasthiti. So when the arms are raised, it's essentially Tadasana. When you're in the starting position, that's just Samasthiti. Now let's practice raising the heels to stand on the toes as well. First, we'll do this in two steps. If you have difficulty with the balance, you could do this facing the wall for balance and just help yourself by having that support. Okay. Now, just the arms first. Inhale, slowly raise your arms out to the sides and up. Lift up your waist, interlace the fingers, stretching up. Now exhale, slowly raise your heels up, keeping the arms up. So now it's the heels moving. And then inhale to lower the heels, slowly with control. Try to coordinate the movement with the breathing. And then exhale, slowly lower your arms down. Now again, inhale, slowly raise just the arms. Interlace fingers stretching up. Exhale, slowly raise your heels up. Inhale to lower the heels. And exhale, slowly lower your arms down. Take a moment, watch your breath. You can just go to normal breathing at this juncture, being in this resting position, just in Samasthiti. We'll try another two times, but this time we'll coordinate the movement of the arms and the heels. Again, if you're using the wall, you can do that for support. So try to make the movement of the heels slow. With the chin gently lowered, your gaze is directed to the floor to help steady the balance. So 2 meters ahead of you on the floor. When you're ready, inhale, slowly raise your heels up, raise your arms up, steady the gaze. Exhale, slowly lower your heels down, lower your arms. Once again, inhale, slowly raise your heels, raise your arms. Exhale, slowly lower your heels down, lower your arms, try to coordinate the movement. Now let's stay in Samasthiti. So, like I said, any of the movements can be repeated, which helps you to really appreciate the breath through the movement. And each position can also be just staying in it. You can prepare for it by repeating it a few times before you then stay in it. But for want of time, we'll move on to the next movement. So as you can see, it's very slow, mindful, and deliberate movements, guided by this long breathing. It's an exquisite breathing technique. You can almost recognize some of the character of this movement with what you might characterize Tai Chi or Qigong. So now, keeping the feet firmly planted, the next movement will just be for the arms. So with an inhale, slowly take just your arms out to the sides and up. Again, keeping the chin down. Interlace the fingers at the top. And now here, exhale and slowly bend the elbows, taking the hands behind the head, but keeping the palms facing up. Hopefully you can see. So not taking the palms to the back of the head, but facing up. Now with an inhale, slowly straighten your arms, press the palms up. Again, exhale, slowly bend the elbows, taking the hands behind the head, palms facing up. Move the elbows back to really open the chest. Inhale, again, slowly straighten your arms, press the palms up. And exhale, slowly bend the elbows, hands behind the head. Palms are facing up. Now keep this arm position. Breathe in. Move the elbows back. Really expand the chest. Exhale there. Again, inhale there. Exhale. Again, inhale. Really get a good stretch inside out. Exhale there. Now inhale, slowly straighten your arms up, press the palms up. And exhale, slowly lower your arms down by your sides. Now, take a moment, watch your breath. So, again, you could go to normal breathing at this point, relax the control of the breath. Just assess the sensation of what you just did in Samasthiti now, just staying there. So the next thing I'll ask you to do now is the standing back arch. So first we'll enter it in the same way that we've been doing with the raising of the arms. So with an inhale, slowly take your arms out to the sides and up. Lift up your waist, interlace the fingers, stretching up. And exhale, slowly lower your arms down. And you could take the arms behind you, and let's grab a hold of the opposite elbows. From here, with an inhale, roll your shoulders back and lift your chest, look up. Exhale, come back to neutral spine, head over heart, taking the chin to the chest. Inhale, slowly roll your shoulders back, lift your chest, look up. Exhale, Come back to neutral spine, head over heart, chin to chest. Inhale, slowly arching back, look up. Exhale, come back to neutral spine, head over heart, chin to chest. Let's do a fourth time. Inhale, arch back. Lift the chest as the shoulders roll back. Let's stay in the position. I'll breathe. So with each inhale, roll the shoulders back. Plug the shoulder blades in and lift the chest. Taking the back arch into the upper chest. Exhaling there. One more breath like this. Inhale. And exhale, come back to neutral spine, head over heart, chin to chest. Now with an inhale, you could take the arms out to the sides and overhead just to complete the movement. Interlace the fingers at the top, keep the chin down. And exhale, slowly lower your arms down by your sides. Breathe out, breathe out, breathe out, breathe out, breathe out. Take a moment, watch your breath. So now let's try the lateral stretch of the spine. We're talking about different movements of the spine that we can do. It's not complicated. There's basically four movements. That was the back arch. Now let's do the lateral stretch of the spine. So with an inhale, slowly take your arms out to the sides and up. Lift up your waist, interlace the fingers, stretching up. And now exhale, side bend to your right side. Keep the gaze forward. Move the hips gently to the opposite direction. Inhale, come up, lift up your waist. Exhale, side bend to the left. Think up and over. The spine moves in one plane. The gaze is forward. Then inhale, come up, lift up your waist. Don't be in a hurry. Exhale, side bend to the right side again. Slowly moving to the position. Maybe you can see if you can bend a wee bit more with each repetition. Inhale, slowly come up. Lift up your waist. Exhale, side bend to the left. Inhale, slowly coming up. Don't rush. Exhale, side bend to the right. Inhale, coming up. Lift up your waist. Exhale, side bend left. I'm doing a mirror image to you. Inhale, coming up. Lift up your waist. Now let's do the fourth time, we'll stay. So exhale, slowly side bend to the right. Now let's stay in the position, breathe. With each exhale, see if you could bend down a wee bit more. Keep the gaze forward, spine moves in one plane. Another breath in, and maybe see about making the exhale longer than the inhale even. Work with the breath. Using the exhalation here. Then inhale, slowly coming up. Lift up your waist and exhale, side bend to the left. Now stay there, breathe. A very long, smooth exhalation can be longer than your inhale. See if you could bend down a wee bit more. Another breath in like this. And a very long, smooth exhalation. Then inhale, slowly coming up, lift up your waist, chin to chest, and exhale, slowly lower your arms down by your sides. Take a moment, watch your breath. Now, we start from more or less equal breathing, but we're not paying attention to such a pedantic degree. But some movements that are exhale oriented may encourage the exhale to be longer, longer than the inhale even. So you can allow this to happen, then the breathing pattern becomes unequal. The expansive movements on inhale shouldn't be longer than the exhale, though, that would follow, because then it could be too much sympathetic nervous system stimulating and even aggravating a sympathetic response. So the exhale, maybe make it equal to the inhale when you're doing the expansive movement. But on the exhale oriented movements, you can allow the exhale to be longer, because that's very good to stimulate the rest and digest aspect of the parasympathetic nervous system. So now let's look at the twisting movement of the spine. So with an inhale, slowly take your arms out to shoulder level, now stopping just at shoulder level, open chest. And now exhale, start to turn to the right. Here you're not locking the knees. You're not locking the knees throughout, and in any case, you're grounding down in the right foot, not the knee. And now as you inhale, slowly undo the twist, come to center. Exhale, slowly twist to the left side, ground down the left foot, left big toe mound. You're not locking the knees. You can look over the left shoulder. And then inhale, slowly undo the twist. Exhale, slowly turn to the right. Hips, waist, abdomen, and chest turn. Inhale, slowly undo the twist, come to center. Exhale, slowly turn to the left. Hips, waist, abdomen, and chest turn. Inhale, slowly undo the twist, come to center. Exhale, slowly turn to the right. Draw the belly in, feel the turn of the spine. Inhale, slowly undo the twist, come to center. Exhale, slowly turn to the left, draw the belly in, feel the turn of the spine. Then inhale, slowly undo the twist, come to center. This will be the fourth time, so let's stay in it. So exhale, slowly turn to the right, draw the belly in, feel the turn of the spine. Now stay in the position. With the next inhale, feel the spine lengthen through to the crown of the head, and with the exhale, draw the belly in and feel the turn of the spine. See if you could twist a wee bit more. Take another breath like this, reaching through the fingertips, the fingers together even, to be even in the stretch. Exhale, turning. And then inhale now to come out. Undo the twist, come to center. And exhale, slowly turn to the left, draw the belly in, feel the turn of the spine. Stay in this position now, breathe. Lengthen the spine through to the crown of the head on inhale. And with exhale, draw the belly in, feel the turn of the spine. Another breath like this. Exhaling. Now inhale, slowly undo the twist, come to center. And then exhale, you slowly lower your arms. Take a moment, watch your breath. You can relax your arms, your shoulders, normal breathing and samasthiti. Just to catch your breath and relax. So the movements can be repeated three times, could be repeated three or even up to six times. You could stay in these movements for, let's say, 3 to 6 breaths. Here we stayed for 3 breaths. And with long breathing, the stay can be considered sufficient. It'll probably be around 30 seconds in a given movement, provided your inhale is 5 seconds and your exhale is 5 seconds. So that's 10 seconds to complete a single round of breath. That's one inhale and one exhale. So to take three breaths, it's about 30 seconds. And 30 seconds in a given stretch is considered sufficient by many. Otherwise, there's some other positions that we can stay longer, certain important positions. But in any case, for now, we're just building the practice. What's another movement we haven't done yet? The forward flexion of the spine. So now we could look at the Uttanasana. There's many different variations, but we'll just start with Ardha Uttanasana, half forward fold. So this is in keeping the back straight when we bend forward just halfway. You start to form like a number seven. We'll even be pushing the hips back as we bend forward, keeping the chin down. So if you feel it's too much strain with the arms forward, you can adjust where you place the arms. Otherwise, if it feels comfortable, the weight of the arms actually will help to strengthen the back. So with an inhale, first raising your arms, keep the chin lowered, lift your waist, interlace the fingers, stretching up. And now exhale, bend halfway, push the hips back, press the palms forward, and come down halfway with a straight back. Slowly with the exhale. And then inhale, slowly coming up. Exhale, slowly bending halfway. All with Ujjayi breathing. Inhale, slowly coming up. And exhale, bending halfway. Now let's stay in these positions. We'll start to stay here, breathing in the position. Again, if you need to adjust the arm position, you can do that. So that was three times the dynamic movement before the stay. Keep the chin down. So you're not like locking the knees as the hips move back. You're just counterbalancing with the hips back. Now inhale, slowly coming up. And exhale, slowly lower your arms down. Take a moment, watch your breath. So you can use the wall if you'd like, bending forward. So coming to the wall like such could be helpful. You can use also support like the chair seat. Now we'll do the full forward fold. And of course you can use any such support like that. You can use the chair back rest or the chair seat. Or the bricks. So we'll do this in a dynamic movement, which will actually help the preparing for the stretch itself. So standing in samasthiti. Inhale now, slowly take your arms out to the sides and up. Stretching up, interlaced fingers. And now exhale, slowly bending all the way down. Uttanasana. So again, you can place the hands to the backrest. Inhale, we'll do it dynamically. Interlace fingers, come all the way up. Exhale, slowly bending all the way down. If you need to bend the knees slightly, you can do that too. Maybe the hands to the chair seat if that was accessible. And then inhale, interlace the fingers, reach forward, slowly coming up. Exhale, slowly coming all the way down, maybe the hands to the bricks or to the ground. Breathe out, breathe out, breathe out. So you can stay in the position now. That was three times dynamically. With an inhale, you can also see about straightening the back, looking forward. And then with an exhale, draw the belly in and bend forward. Head down, relaxed neck, staying in the position now. Emphasize a long, smooth exhalation. Maybe the fingertips could come to the floor. There's many variations. You could even do uttanasana, grabbing the big toes. It becomes parangushtasana. Now, we'll move out of this in any case. So inhale, interlace the fingers, reach forward, slowly coming up. With control, the arms lead the movement, really. Exhale, slowly lower your arms down by your sides. Take a moment, watch your breath. Now, we've done flexion, but what else is there? Well, if you notice, we've been sequentially moving through the joints in the body. So the next joint would be the knees. We're working with the hips and the forward flexion, uttanasana. Now, if we work with the knees, we'll be doing utkatasana, chair pose or awkward pose. So we could try that. First, the ardha utkatasana, half utkatasana, is like squatting. If it's possible, you could do it with the feet together. If you need to have the feet apart, you could do that. You can also have the hands to the wall for support. Now, with an inhale, slowly take your arms out to the sides and up. Lift up your waist, interlace the fingers, stretching up. And now exhale to bend the knees. Coming halfway, you could try to parallel the thighs with the floor. Inhale, slowly coming up with control. You see, slowly doing the movement, it's strengthening. With control, exhale, slowly coming halfway down. With control, this is strengthening. Inhale, slowly coming up. See, it trains the muscles that take you out of the pose equally as the muscles that would otherwise take you into the pose. Exhale, come halfway. Otherwise, people focus so much on getting to the pose, they don't pay attention to how they come out. Now stay in the pose. Chin to chest, breathing there. Emphasize exhale to steady the effort. Now inhale, slowly coming up with control. Don't be in a hurry. Exhale, slowly lower your arms. Take a moment, watch your breath. So you can see just in this Tadasana sequence, it's a very well-rounded practice. It has all of the basic movements. There's many variations we can add on, but this is the basic sequence of Tadasana. The next thing we could do is a more complete squat, the full Utkatasana. Not everyone could do this. Maybe some people have a sensitivity in the knees. So maybe you want to use actually a counter pose. The counter pose to Utkatasana could be Uttanasana, just the regular forward fold. So if you prefer to do that, you can do that. Otherwise, you could try the full squat. Again, if you prefer doing with the feet apart, maybe you'll find it easier. The classical position as part of this Tadasana sequence is with the feet together. But please be sensitive to your needs. Don't be striving in your asana practice. That's ego-driven, and it's not conducive to yoga. So choose your medicine. It's your practice, not mine. So some people with the feet together, they'll notice that they can't keep the heels down when they come all the way down. Maybe they could keep the heels down if they do with the feet apart. If you want to do with the feet together and the heels come up, you can always ground down in some sort of a support, placing the heels elevated on a support to begin, so that when you come down to a more complete squat, the heels are grounding down in any case. Otherwise, you can maybe come down only so far that you keep the heels down with control. If your heels tend to come up, only going as low as you still have control. You can even only do the half squat if you want to repeat what we just did. Otherwise, you could try the full squat, grounding the heels down. We'll do an easier arm variation where the arms are just forward, which will help for balance in any case. Again, if you want to do Uttanasana, the forward fold, as a counter pose instead of this, you could do that too. So inhale, here just we'll raise the arms forward, just in front, shoulder level. And now exhale, slowly coming all the way down. Breathe out, breathe out, breathe out, breathe out, breathe out. Draw the navel towards the spine. Inhale, slowly coming up with control, slowly. See, it's strengthening this. Exhale, slowly coming all the way down. Inhale, slowly coming up. Exhale, slowly coming all the way down. Now stay in the position, breathe in there. You may notice the inhale may be short here, but try to keep the exhale long and smooth. Navel draws towards the spine. You keep the chin down. Another couple of breaths like this, with a very long, smooth exhalation. Another breath like this. Exhaling. Now inhale, carefully coming up with control. Mindfully, and exhale, slowly lower your arms. Take a moment, watch your breath. Let's do Tadasana on the toes now. So this time again, we'll coordinate the movement of the heels and the arms. We'll do it three times and then we'll stay the third time. Try to synchronize the movement. The heels moving slowly, steady the gaze. Inhale, slowly raise your heels up and arms. Exhale, slowly lower your heels down, lower your arms. Inhale, slowly coming up. Exhale, slowly lower down. Inhale, coming up. Now stay in the position, breathe. Steady the gaze, be tall like a palm tree. If the feet are together, you can actually press the heels into one another. Might help. And now exhale, slowly lower your heels down, lower your arms. Now stay in Sanastiti. Catch your breath. Now, we'll transition to come to the ground. So, or shall we? Maybe let's do another standing category before we do that. So let's do the Trikonasana. You can have the bricks set up to the sides there. You can also practice with a chair. You know, you can also take the hand to the shin or the ankle. So standing at the center of the mat, towards the long edge of the mat, with an inhale, take your arms out to shoulder level, exhale, and then hold the breath out, and then walk or jump the feet apart, and then 3 feet apart. So actually the feet being the distance of one of your legs, so it forms like an equilateral triangle. Okay. So for today, we'll do the foot position that many will likely be familiar with this, what they teach in Iyengar yoga. So that is also seen in Ashtanga Vinyasa, except we won't bother with holding the big toe. In fact, Ashtanga Vinyasa is the only school that teaches the detail of holding the big toe. Krishnamacharya was not showing that in his photographs, and Iyengar didn't teach that. Ramaswami doesn't teach that. Desikachar doesn't teach it. But in any case, with an exhale, you can turn your right foot out 90 degrees and your left foot just pointing forwards. So here, like I said, this is the position you're likely familiar with. Ramaswami teaches a different position, but we won't get into that today. So here, stamping down the inner edge of the front foot, the outer edge of the back foot, back leg straight and strong, and rolling the thighs out. Make sure that your front knee is pointing in the direction of the toes, right? Try to resist the tendency for the hips to go in this regard towards the front leg. This being the front leg, your right leg. So try to firm the hips so that they're pointing forward in one line, more or less, stamping down the inner edge of the front foot, the outer edge of the back foot. Okay. Lifting up your side waist, your armpit, chest. Roll the shoulders back. You can inhale, take your arms out to shoulder level. And now exhale, side bend to the right side. We'll do this a few times. So you can bend the front knee if you need to, or you can keep it straight and use the support. Maybe take the hand to the backrest of a chair, or the hand just to the thigh. Inhale to come up. Exhale, come down. You could take the hand to the chair seat, or maybe just to the shin. Inhale, slowly. Coming up with control. So no hurry. Go slowly with the breathing. Exhale, slowly coming down. So again, the hand could come to the shin or maybe the brick behind. So now we'll stay in the position. Roll the shoulders back. Try to turn the chest away from the floor. And if it's comfortable, you can even look up towards the hand that's in the air. You can have the fingers together, really reaching up. When the fingers are actually together rather than spread, you're focusing the stretch in one direction. This is the manner in which my teacher teaches it. Now inhale, carefully come up, watch your spine. And then exhale, you can lower your hands to your hips, your feet to center. Catch your breath. This is the first variation of Trikonasana, it's just the lateral stretch of the spine. Of course, there's also the twisted variation. And like I said, in all of these categories, you can almost get to most or all of the types of movements of the spine. So that was a lateral stretch. Of course, with feet apart, you can verily bend forward. You can also do the twist, like I mentioned. You can also arch the spine like the warrior Virabhadrasana. But in any case, we're just going to do Trikonasana for now. With an inhale, take your arms out to shoulder level. And now exhale, pivot your left foot out. So now your left foot turns out 90 degrees and your right foot could just point forwards. Stamp down the inner edge of the front foot, the outer edge of the back foot. Back leg straight and strong. Roll your thighs out and make sure your left knee is in the direction of your toes. Make sure your hips are in line, facing forward towards the front edge, or not the front edge, but the long edge of your mat. Tailbone in. Lift your waist, lift your armpit chest. Roll your shoulders back. Inhale, take your arms out to shoulder level. And then exhale, slowly bend to your left side now. Long exhale, slowly moving to the posture. You could take your hand to the backrest of the chair or to your thigh, or the inhale coming up now. Exhale, slowly bending down again. Slow movements, long breathing. I'm just guiding the support. You can also take it to the chair seat or maybe to the hand to the shin. Inhale, carefully coming up. Exhale, slowly bending again. Maybe the hand comes to the shin or the brick. Stay in the position now. Roll the shoulders back. Try to turn the chest away from the floor. You can look towards the hand that's in the air if that's comfortable. Keep the fingers together and reaching through the fingertips. Use the exhale. Maybe you can bend down comfortably with each exhale. See if you could go a little further to your capacity. Now inhale, slowly, carefully coming up. Watch your spine. And then exhale, you can take the feet to center. Lower your hands to your hips. And then hold the breath out and walk or jump your feet together. And you can lower your arms down by your sides. Something else you could do is the Parsva Uttanasana, or otherwise known as Parsva Uttanasana. So again, you can work with the chair or you can use bricks. So here, standing in Samasthiti, with an inhale, take your arms out to shoulder level. Exhale, hold the breath out and walk or jump the feet apart. So now here you could inhale, take your arms overhead. So here the feet could be just one leg's distance apart, three, maybe about 3 feet, or depending on your what's it called? The length of your leg anyways. So with an exhale, you could turn now your right leg, right foot out 90 degrees, and here even turning your left foot in slightly and actually turn the whole body to face right this time. It's a different alignment. Don't worry about squaring necessarily. That's not so important. I know it may be for Iyengar yoga, but just be comfortable. Just be intuitive of how to approach and not so concerned about the alignment, because alignment often is more aesthetic than biomechanic. Stamp down the inner edge of the front foot, the outer edge of the back foot. The back leg will remain straight and strong. If you need to bend the front leg at any point, you could do it. Otherwise, you could keep it straight and use support. So with an inhale, tailbone in, lift your waist, lift your chest. And now exhale, bend forward slowly using the exhale. Again, you can use the support. You could place the hands to the backrest of a chair. Inhale, slowly coming up. We'll do it dynamically to prepare the movement. Exhale, bending again. If you need to bend slightly in the front knee, you can always do it. You could place the hands to the chair seat. Inhale, slowly coming up with control. Exhale, slowly bending down. Maybe the hands to the bricks. With an inhale, you can straighten the spine, look forward. And exhale, lower down. If it's comfortable, of course, you can place the hands to the floor, maybe even just the fingertips. Go to your capacity. Lift the inner arch of the back foot, the front edge of the inner edge of the front foot will press down, the outer edge of the back foot will press down. Now inhale, interlace the fingers, reach forward, slowly coming up. If you need to bend slightly in the front leg as you come up, you can always do it. And then exhale, you could come to center and lower your hands to your hips. Now, if you were using the bricks, you can move it over to the other side. If you comfortably bring the hands to the floor, you can do that too. Otherwise, there's a chair you can use. So with an inhale, you could take your arms overhead, interlace the fingers, reaching up rather. And now exhale, pivot the feet to the left side. So left foot turns out 90 degrees, right foot could turn in, and you could turn the whole body to face right. Stamp down the inner edge of the front foot, the outer edge of the back foot, back leg straight and strong, tailbone in. Inhale, lift your waist, lift your chest. And now exhale, slowly, carefully bending forward. If you need to bend slightly in the front leg, you can do it. Otherwise, take support, maybe the backrest of the chair. Inhale, carefully coming up, grounding down the feet to come up. If you need to bend slightly as you come up in the front leg, you can do it. Exhale, slowly bending forward. You can also place the hands to the chair seat. Inhale, carefully coming up. If you need to bend slightly in the front knee to come up, you can do it. Exhale, slowly bending down, maybe using the bricks or fingers to the floor, maybe palms to the floor. With an inhale, you can straighten the spine, look forward, straight arms. Exhale, slowly bending forward. Stamp down the inner edge of the front foot, outer edge of the back foot. Raise the inner arch of the back foot. If it's comfortable to place the fingers on the floor or the palms, you can do that. Use the breathing. Focus on long breathing. Emphasize exhale for this position. Now inhale, carefully coming up. If you need to bend slightly in the front knee to come up, you can do it. Exhale, come to center. Lower the hands to the hips and hold the breath out and walk or jump the feet together. Drop your arms by your side, samasthiti. All right. So now, let's go ahead and come to the ground like I was saying. So you may know the transition sequence that involves jumping. We could do that in Vinyasa Krama, Ramaswami Sir teaches it, but he also teaches us an alternate way of coming down, which doesn't involve the weight bearing. We could just simply come down through a squat, of course, still with mindful breathing. So today, especially for first class, we'll not do any such jumping procedures. We'll just come down through a squat. Of course, you could sit down on a chair or on your bed. So So in any case, standing at the front edge of your mat, with an inhale, slowly take your arms all the way up. Interlace the fingers, stretching up. Exhale, slowly bending your knees, coming to the squat. If your heels come up here, it's okay, because we're going to come sit down in any case. And then you can use your hands on the floor to help lower your hips and straighten your legs forward. Now, remember what I said. If the sitting position, your spine is compromised, you're rolling back, you're unable to sit towards the front edges of your sit bones, which are basically like knuckles, you may need to sit up on a height. Just take whatever you need. Now, let's relax for a moment in Shavasana. We did some supine and we did some standing. We could think of practice of in terms of organizing a sequence that combines categories from different planes of movement. We started with supine that prepared us to come do some standing. Maybe for today we won't do any seated variations, we'll just stay with the supine start and the standing. So for now, let's just come to sit, to lie down. If you want to do so with the knees bent, or you can place something underneath the knees for support, like a pillow or cushions, you can do it. Or you can just lie without such support. Be in the corpse pose, so allow the feet to roll out, palms face up, and completely relax. Watch your breath. Here it's normal breathing, relaxed, but keep watch of your breath. Now coming back to your body, just a short rest. When you're ready, you could turn to your right side and eventually coming up to a seated position. And we'll come to a position for pranayama, the seated breath control exercises. Could be a cross leg position, could be a kneeling position. Of course, if you're sitting on a chair or on the edge of your bed, you could do that too. Sitting upright. So chin lowered, eyes closed. Let's go back to that Brahmari pranayama technique where we extend the exhale. So when you're ready, you can begin. Let's count six breaths doing that. And so you can do it with your pace. See about extending your exhale little by little. Make it longer than your inhale. Now you can release this. We'll try another pranayama technique where it's a sort of hybrid technique. We'll do ujjayi on inhales. So that's with the throat constriction through both nostrils. And then on exhale, you release the throat constriction and the control rather will be in the nostrils itself. We'll alternate nostril on exhale. So for this, we'll need a mudra in the right hand. It's called Mrigi Mudra. Some people call it Vishnu Mudra or Shankha Mudra. In any case, my teacher calls it Mrigi Mudra, in which we bend the index and middle finger of your right hand. As such, the ring and little finger will of course be used on the left side, just below the bone, and the thumb will be used on the right side, just below the bone where the cartilage meets the bone. You'll want to remove any specs if you have any on. If it's too complicated, this you could just take whatever position is comfortable for you for closing one nostril. Otherwise, you can have this mudra. It's always in this manner. with the spine erect, the head doesn't turn. The spine must be straight, chin centered, taking the hand to the nose, not taking your nose to the right, to the right hand. Okay? So sit tall, chin lowered, eyes closed. We'll begin by exhaling to completely empty the lungs. Now inhale Ujjayi, both nostrils. Without throat constriction, close the left nostril, breathe out through the right nostril. Now you can lower the hand and inhale through both nostrils with Ujjayi. And then close the right nostril, breathe out through the left nostril. Then inhale, both nostrils, Ujjayi, you could lower the hand. And then exhale, right nostril. Try to make the exhale a little longer. So it could be longer than your inhale. Then you can lower the hand, inhale, both nostrils, Ujjayi. And then exhale left nostril. You see if you can make it a little longer than the inhale. Then inhale both nostrils, Ujjayi. And then exhale right nostril. See if you can make it even approaching twice as long as the inhale. Then inhale both nostrils, Ujjayi. And then exhale, left nostril. See if you can approach twice as long as the inhale. Then you can relax the breathing, lower the hand. So this emphasis on making the exhale subtle, of course, is for the parasympathetic nervous system, the rest and digest. It's pacifying as such. And also with the exhale moving through a single nostril, it's the air is moving with the hairs in the nostril, with the grain. So that's also pacifying. If you were doing the opposite, it would be causing more friction and is more stimulating. But this is more pacifying, this technique, by virtue of the long exhale, just by that nature, and also by this alternate nostril specifically on the exhale. It's called Anuloma Ujjayi. Anuloma implies with the grain. Now let's conclude by chanting Om together once. If you're not comfortable chanting Om, you could just hum like the Brahmari technique. Otherwise you could chant Om or whatever sound you'd like, even Amen. Something auspicious like that is thought to be very potent. Om is thought to be a potent syllable, thought to be the cosmic sound, the primal throb of the universe as such. In any case, let's take a deep inhalation. Thanks for joining for today's practice. Hope you enjoyed. And please come again. Please stick around for the subsequent practice that will be uploaded at some point in the future, where we add some different variations exploring with this long breathing technique. So hope you enjoyed. If you have any questions, please write them in the comments or send me a message. And until next time, all the best.